funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and by other public television stations, and by the following.
John Kenneth Galbraith has written his memoirs, as everyone who reads knows. But since everyone who reads, in the confident conclusion of Professor Galbraith, excludes anyone who is conservative, those conservatives viewing this program are, by special request of our guest, advised that the book is called A Life in Our Times, that it is available at any bookstore for $16.95. Meanwhile, your host, in my characteristic attempt to be helpful, advises you that the same book could have been bought for $6.95, except that the Democratic Congresses that have made inflation during the past generation have been enacting policies recommended in Professor Galbraith's book. You should rush out to buy it now, because the trajectory of inflation is not easily collapsed, and one can only hope to make economic progress during those indecently short intervals between the publication of Professor Galbraith's books. This is his 21st book, but not on that account are we entitled to conclude that Professor Galbraith has reached maturity. He still rejoices in the old enthusiasms, the New Deal, price controls, high taxes, central economic control, the practice of laissez-faire only where communist expansionism has occurred. But he manages to say all these things and to describe his life and his collaborations and his collisions with its principal figures with such charm and self-satisfied glee that he carries us all along like traveling in a barge with vintage wines and vintage talk. So what does it matter if ahead of us are the Niagara Falls? Which, by way of specific information, would spill Professor Galbraith back into Canada, whence the plague arose. From studying agriculture there, he went to Berkeley, where he honed his superstitions, then to Washington, where he told us during the war how much we could pay for tomato ketchup, then to Fortune magazine, which will have to bear the historical responsibility for teaching him to write some of the most graceful language being written, then to Harvard to corrupt the youth and produce his formidably influential trilogy, The Affluent Society, The New Industrial State, and Economics and the Public Purpose. He was appointed ambassador to India, whereupon India engaged in a war, and is generally credited with masterminding the brilliant political campaigns of Adlai Stevenson, Eugene McCarthy, George McGovern, and Edward Kennedy. Our examiner is Mr. Arya Nair, who will be introduced in due course. No subject is untouched in Mr. Galbraith's book, and so perforce one must be arbitrary. I think it useful, given current controversy, to discuss some of the implications of Mr. Reagan's economic proposals, and we'll begin by alluding to Mr. Galbraith's most recent writing, an essay in the New York Times Magazine on the uses and excuses for affluence. I should like to begin by asking Mr. Galbraith to explain why he wants to tax at 70% or more the savings of people who invested their money in savings accounts, say.
Well, people who are in the 70% bracket are not heavy users of savings accounts, so along with the...
Well, that's how they got into that bracket, so, by saving.
So along with the charming and rather massive amount of misinformation in that introduction, omits to tell about Buckley and the Reagan thrust back to the 18th century, I make no apologies for having accepted the world of the New Deal. And you do, don't you, Bill? Do you accept the New Deal as a historic event, or one to be, in the best Buckley manner, reversed?
Well, I'm glad you're defensive about it. It is.
I'm not.
There's a lot to be defensive.
All.
I think there's a lot to be defensive about a society that fought its way clear of the tyrannies of George III. Which I think most people would welcome in return for those being exercised by Washington today.
You are not pre-George III. That's the first time I ever heard that. My God.
No, Bill, I would have joined in that revolution for the same reason that I would oppose the New Deal.
You're moving on all the time, aren't you?
But now, are you through with the New Deal, or shall I rub it in?
But to get back to the tax system, certainly, I regard the income tax, enacted incidentally by Republicans, William Howard Taft, as one of the great progressive instruments of our time, and something with an enormously conservative effect. The reason being that if you leave the system to the kind of unbridled free enterprise, which you and Ronald Reagan and Mr. Reagan and company would like, then you're going to have a depth of anger and dissatisfaction among other things, has no conservative value or effect.
Well, the amount of dissatisfaction and irrationality that prevailed during the late 60s and early 70s had nothing to do with anything with which I have any sympathy. I don't even believe in civil disobedience, except when somebody gets in the way of my rights of conscience.
Sorry. But so you would agree with me that
Taft, you have to admit, had nothing to do with the passage of the amendment. He happened simply to be president at the time.
You would agree with me, wouldn't you, then, that a certain sense of equality and a sense of fairness in the society is a great source of social tranquility and something which you, as a conservative, would wish to have me, as a liberal, advocate.
I think it's contra naturem. I think what everybody requires and is entitled to is the opportunity to use his talents to prefer industry to sloth. But there has got to be a reason for doing so. And the extent that you procrustianize society, you are precisely telling people that they cannot enjoy the fruits of their own talent. It would be like telling you that you couldn't write any books, which, come to think of it, is not a bad idea. Maybe we should have a quota on books.
You go farther than I would. You would then wipe out all inheritance in order that everybody start even.
No, because one of the motivations for people's work is to make life easier for their children.
Okay,
it's an extremely important motivation.
Oh, children, grandchildren.
It's a principal aspect of altruism.
Children and grandchildren, I won't worry. You say you would have all grandchildren start fresh, rather than have the unearned advantage of some ancient grandparent. I would not go that far, Bill.
I'll make a deal with you. I'll tell you what I want to say. I'll save you the problem of telling me what I say.
But I merely go on to accept the simple logic of your positions.
The logic of my position is that a society is not a tranquil society in which there are artificial impediments to individual advancement. If one were to say, for instance, there are 6% Jews in America, and therefore only 6% people can go to Harvard, I would consider that an artificial impediment and a source of dissatisfaction with which I would be in sympathy. I take it you would not.
You're struggling very hard to find some position with which I would agree, but I agree with that. I see. But have you reflected, Bill?
Well, if you agree with that, then you have to deny, for instance, affirmative action.
Have you reflected, Bill, how far you went from 70% taxation in order to get something where your position was sort of solid and sane?
No, I'm very much opposed to 70% taxation. I'm in favor of 25% maximum tax, as is Milton Friedman, from whom you once said in a conversation with me and perhaps publicly, was the most important social innovator of our time.
Yes, because there is something on which Friedman and I have basically agreed, which is that the most important source of freedom in our society, or at least one of the most important, one I value, one I think even you value, is having some money to spend. And that if you have a basic income of the sort that was advocated by Milton Friedman and George McGovern and Richard Nixon, Friedman called it the negative income tax, that this is a very important contribution to freedom. And let me ask you this, Bill. Did you support the Friedman on the negative income tax?
No, I would support him only if it were passed in circumstances which would make it absolutely poisonous to you, i.e. as a substitute for those 128 other measures that you also endorse so heartily.
This is the...
And Milton Friedman himself did not support the FAP, and not uninterestingly, its principal architect, Senator Moynihan, has since renounced it on the grounds that empirical studies show that it hurts rather than helps. But your studies in redistribution should have led you, while you were in India, to advocate what, a minimum wage of $5 an hour?
No, certainly not. The,
are you turning your back on a minimum wage?
My economics, unlike yours, involves a constant adaptation to the contemporary scene.
Mm-hmm. And the contemporary scene is inflationary.
And the contemporary scene, as one finds it in India, I think I could almost persuade you, Bill, that the contemporary scene in India is different from that of the United States.
And, yes.
And I would suppose, I would suppose there was a certain weakness in your polemical style in having to go to India in order to find a proposition to refute my manifest common sense.
Well, of course, your manifest common sense led you to despair in your book about India over the endemic poverty which, not surprisingly, continues to obtain in a country that is explicitly socialist.
No.
No, what?
I must correct you, huh? India combines certain overtures to socialist rhetoric with some of the most rapacious capitalists to be found anywhere in the world. After all, it is a society of 70% small farmers who have no disposition to socialism whatever. You mustn't argue with me on India.
Why do they elect socialists?
I don't. You made a polemical mistake in going to India, because I know so much more about India than you do, even though you know more about. You know more about the technique of.
I have the disadvantage of having read your book. on India, in which you confess your utter despair in confronting some of the problems in India.
There is a question. There are times when, I don't want to say unlike you, I retreat into realism. And the poverty of India is one great realistic fact. But it has nothing, I promise you, Bill, nothing to do with ideology. It has an enormous amount to do with the concentration of vast millions of people on very limited, primitive land resources, and that is the cause of poverty.
What's the cause of wealth in Japan? Because everything else is the same that you just said.
Yeah,
lots of people with very little land.
I think there's no simple answer, but certainly
acceptable answer.
There's a large investment in producing one of the most diligent, literate, well-educated people in the world. All by social action had something a lot to do with it.
Yeah.
Are
you aware that there's no 70% tax rate in Japan?
No,
are you aware that there's no capital gain tax whatsoever?
I think the tax rate in Japan only goes up to 65% or something of that sort.
Well,
you're not going to quarrel about 5%, are you?
Well, I will quarrel. I will quarrel about 5% unemployment, for instance. 5% is or is not important.
You're changing the subject, Buckley. You're changing the subject.
5% is or is not important depending on its context. For instance, if you say 5% of all Jews are killed, then that would be a very grave figure. If you say 5% increase in the price of Coca-Cola tomorrow, that would not be a grave figure. But the fact of the matter is, we have inflation, we have a slow growth in the GNP, and we have Galbraithian economics. And I say that the reason for the first two is the third.
Well, there were various gaps there that I missed, and I don't want you to repeat it because possibly the audience got it. But I must say it was so murky that maybe it would be well to go over it again.
Well, a moment ago, I began by citing the Constitution, which gives to the House of Representatives the right to initiate all money bills, right? And I said that we had had Democratic Congresses during a period when we have launched into inflation. You were so offended at the notion that you reminded me that Nixon was president, but Nixon didn't initiate the money bills.
Nixon and Ford managed to produce really the most serious post-war inflation up until the present.
Ford cut inflation from 9% to 4.5% in 18 months, and your guy then tripled it.
Want
to quarrel with that?
I had certain differences of opinion with Jimmy Carter. We might drop the persiflage for a moment. Mm-hmm. I would like to see a much stronger fiscal policy. I would like to see a much more strongly balanced budget than we have. And I react with horror I react really with mild horror.
It's going to be good.
To this conservative wave of large tax reductions, large increases in military expenditure, including the disinterring of those museum pieces called battleships, all at the same time that we are presumed that we have double-digit inflation.
Why didn't you react in horror when President Kennedy, your hero, came out for a very substantial tax reductions, especially in the higher brackets, and substantial increases because of our missile gap?
I did.
You did?
Oh, yes, I was opposed to it.
Oh, that must have been your secret book.
You must know it was well known.
Is it in your journals?
It was well known at the time. It's in my journal.
Well, do you deplore the results, which were, in fact, an increase in federal revenues?
I always thought we should have larger social expenditure at that time.
Yeah, but I said you deplore the fact that the people were correct who said, if you tax less, you're going to end up getting more, which is what happened.
Let me put the circumstances. At the time of the Kennedy tax cuts, which I must say I opposed because I was for more social spending at that time, I thought that we had social urgencies of a very high order. The possible difference of opinion here, we had a very high level of employment. We had stable prices. We had a close hold through the guidelines on the wage price spiral. Under those circumstances, and very nearly a budget surplus. Now, if you conservatives move from that situation to one where we have a very, very high rate of inflation, a prospective very large increase in military expenditures with tight bottlenecks that will make it worse, and a big tax cut, you're reasoning by a kind of analogy that if the Democrats did this sort of thing, Bill, you would be outraged. You know that.
Well,
now, you must not allow your commitment to the people you love in politics to outweigh your common sense.
No, but I accept your earlier injunction to adapt to circumstances.
I rely on you as a stalwart conservative. Well, as a fixed piece of imagery in the economic system.
As a stalwart conservative, I'm in a position to reiterate certain truths that you forgot somewhere about the time you left Ontario. And they are that you cannot have a progressive capital plant unless you have savings. We have savings of 5% per year compared to Japanese savings, compared to German savings of twice as much and Japanese savings of three times as much. And interestingly enough, the rates of taxation are almost exactly in inverse correlation.
No, the German tax system is about the same as ours.
No, they have no capital gains at all.
Zero. You must, of zero. All the myriads
or
of taxes.
If it's less than zero, I'll see
you.
You
must,
see
of all of those myriads of taxes, pick out the one. The German social expenditures and tax structure is just about as rigorous as ours, maybe slightly more so.
Well,
now, the Japanese is much less.
In fact, there are only two countries in Europe that have a higher taxes than we do.
And you must also bear in mind, while you're you and your friends are busy egregiously increasing this military budget, that one of the reasons that the Germans and the Japanese have this high rate of saving is that they have not been using their resources.
Well, if you're saying that we should put pressure on them to increase their participation in their own defense, I agree with you. And if you want to play that violin, I'll play along with you.
Would you also agree with me as a fiscal conservative that we might have, in this age of overkill, this age of massive potential destruction, two things, a much sharper view of our own military expenditures, and also a much stronger pressure on arms control to get these hideous weapons under control. Wouldn't you agree with that?
I would agree that we should do whatever satisfies us most reasonably that we won't use those arms.
I detect a hedge here somehow or other.
Well, I'd like
yes.
to... That's because I have a way of saying things with
a
certain precision.
As I like to press an interrogator, occasionally I like to have a yes or no.
Except, you know, as such precision as keeps me from saying such things as that Senator McGovern was going to win by a landslide.
That's why I sometimes talk more slowly
than you.
Look, in order to maintain credibility, I want to confess I have an unparalleled record of error in political forecasts. Mm-hmm. Do you ever confess error?
Oh, when I make it, which is why I'm so silent. So the fact of the matter, obviously, what we want is not to have to fight a war, which tends to happen when we have democratic administrations. And under the circumstances, we must be strong enough to keep anybody from using those weapons. This is a position, really, which is not unorthodox, and I don't think is one that has been... Are you in favor of unilateral disarmament?
No, I'm not in favor of unilateral disarmament, but I would certainly get going rapidly on the suicidal arms race.
What if the Soviet Union didn't cooperate?
The Soviets have repeatedly and consistently indicated that they're no more suicidal than we are.
Well, the trouble with that is the Soviets tell only you and William Sloan Coffin this, but they never tell it to our negotiators.
It's in the newspapers every day. You don't read the papers.
It's in the newspapers every day, sure. It's in the United Nations speeches also. But when we offered to throw away all of our atomic bombs and invited them to do so, also 1946, the Baruch plan and the Lilienthal plan, they simply changed the subject.
Puzzles me at that time because they didn't have any at that time.
They were stealing them from us at a regular rate.
I have to keep you back to information. Mm-hmm. 1946, are you saying that in 1946 the Soviets had a nuclear arsenal?
I was a year off, 5%.
Pardon?
I was 5% off. The Baruch and the Lilienthal plans were 47, 48.
At long last, a Buckley error is admitted.
That's right. The plan, you will remember, was we will never know
the full possibilities of negotiation until we negotiate.
We have negotiated.
And this is something, and
we concluded a treaty. We concluded two treaties.
I was strongly in favor of SALT II, and I must say that the fact that the Reagan administration is adhering to its terms is something in its favor.
Well, it is adhering to its terms as a matter of convenience, but it has made it explicit. Understanding that it is not bound either by the terms of SALT II or of SALT I, which, of course, has lapsed.
These are legal trivialities, which I don't think throwing away
300 international ICBMs is a legal triviality. We haven't, in fact, done that. Now there's the Soviet Union. Under SALT II, you remember, they were supposed to produce. They haven't done so.
Well,
so they're not adhering to the plans of the
In any case, I'm so do you want getting away that? From the trivialities. I want very much to get these negotiations underway. I want to survive. I want to see have all these young people survive. I don't think that the Soviets are instinctively, as I say, more suicidal than some of our people.
Do you consider yourself having made an outrageously provocative statement by saying you want to survive?
Sometimes, given some of the people that you're supporting, I really feel there is. Yes.
Who am I supporting who wants to go to war?
Oh, no, Bill, I take that back. I hope that nobody in this world wants war.
Well, unhappily, I think some people do.
Because I take the position, you don't have to reverse it immediately.
Well, the people who marched into Afghanistan wanted war, didn't they?
The movement into Afghanistan, I thought, and continue to think, was a manifestation of weakness, that here was a failing Marxist regime of notable incompetence, which the Soviets, I think mistakenly, certainly, were disposed to rescue, that it wasn't a manifestation of Soviet strength, but a manifestation of the weakness of the regime which had existed there before.
Well, if Afghanistan had been, let's say, 100 times as strong as it is, the probability is that they would not have been...
If there had been a strong Marxist regime there, I agree with you, they wouldn't have moved in.
I didn't say Marxist, I said strong regime, period.
Oh, but you're not suggesting that military power is possible in Afghanistan.
I'm suggesting that you have exactly given the principal architecture of my own position on how to guard the peace. You say that the Soviet Union is having internal difficulties and under the circumstances is looking for soft parts of the world in which to exercise itself. I don't want to be one of those soft parts.
No, I didn't say that, and I don't think
we're rapidly becoming under a democratic president.
Oh, I don't think that for a moment, Bill, but there are some points where your aberrations are so vast that I can't contend with them.
Well, did you think we had a missile gap at a time that President Kennedy ran on that issue?
This, I think, was a great mistake of the Democrats at that time. The missile gap, I think, did not turn out to exist.
Was resisting Hitler a great mistake?
I'm forced to confess that that I did not at that time have a sufficient awareness of the issues and of the hardware so that I had a useful view. But then we get back to the same tendency, Bill, which I must warn you against. I speak about economics and you go over to the admission of Jewish students to Harvard. I speak of the need for a rational, sensible effort to get these hideous weapons under control, and I find you back with Adolf, of all things, with Adolf Hitler. Now,
well, you see, it requires a little artistry to cause you to be consistent. And that means that I have to run around with pots of paint for you to dab onto your palette in order to make a consistent position.
That metaphor.
We both want peace, but you want weakness.
That metaphor escapes me about the dabs of paint. Would you put it
in? Well, I have to keep cleaning up and providing you with colors in order to come up with a coherent program.
No, but it's the metaphor I want to explain, Bill.
It's a metaphor.
Yeah.
Well, if you have only blues and you try to paint something that's picturesque, you're going to have difficulty, right?
This still bothers me. Do you get that metaphor?
These are very imaginative people. The issue of peace is or is not related to the issue of the economy, because you began, in effect, by saying one of the reasons we're in trouble is because we're spending so much on arms, and then you went off to
the issue of
the primacy of guarding the peace, with, however, dodging the question whether we should be willing to pay for the arms.
Oh no, I'm not a unilateralist, but I am for, as I say, I am for the need to recognize that as. As the former Ambassador Watson said yesterday at Harvard, in a brilliant speech.
Who wrote it?
Recognize the common interest that.
Did you write it?
No, I certainly didn't. I would have even more ecstatic description if I had written it. And if you had written it, I would even be aware again of the metaphors that. Crept in and recognized the source.
I didn't mean to get in the way of your communicating the brilliance of his insight, which was
which is that there is mutuality, a common interest, and that this is something of and the most urgent question in the world today.
Well, is the most urgent question of the world served though? By simply assuming that the Soviet Union is going to repeal its stated goals, which are, after all, the source of the misery to which you allude. The difficulties the Soviet Union is having are at least traceable in substantial part to the fact that they are devoting 15 to 16% of their gross national product to arms, whose only intention is aggressive, right?
No, I don't think so. I don't think that they... I think that we deal here, Bill, with a technological trap of massive power and deep concern, where there is an innovation on our side, a matching innovation on their side, an effort to improve one side or the other, and that we've become subject to, become the victims of this technology, which, of course, in both countries is reinforced by economic and bureaucratic interest. And also the fact that in this game of horror, there are certain people who become specialists in horror, and the rest of us turn our minds away from it, hoping that it will somehow go away, that we won't have to think about anything as disastrous as this. Well, I've persuaded myself that we must think about this vision of horror, and that we must bring the largest number of people, including the largest number of people who are watching this program, into a concern for getting these negotiations back underway.
Well, I agree.
Reflecting the common interest that there is in both countries.
I couldn't agree with you more, but I also agree with a Democratic Secretary of State about whom you were once enthusiastic, less so in later years, Dean Acheson, who said that he thought that the United States ought to seek peace by dealing from situations of strength. And it is, as I understand it, the strategy of the current administration to develop those situations of strength, the purpose being to force the Soviet Union realistically to come to the bargaining table.
Well, if we already have the capacity of destroying them five or six times over, how much more strength do we need, Bill?
But that's, you see, that's such an irrelevant figure. It's terribly surprised to hear somebody as sophisticated as you using it. We have enough BB bullets to destroy everybody, but that doesn't mean that our BB bullets are an effective weapon against an international capability that can take out our IBM bases.
We come back again to these...
Our ICBM bases.
Come back again to these ghastly metaphors. We've moved from IBMs to BB bullets. I haven't followed you, and I venture the thought that even highly intelligent audience is going to have difficulty following
The trouble with, if I may say so, the trouble with people who have your characteristic of thought, if I can say that about anybody other than you, is that...
Say it about me, Bill. I have a thick,
Seymour Melman came up with a notion of overkill about 20 years ago. New people have been living off it, just as 20 years earlier somebody came up with the fact that deficit spending doesn't matter because we owe it to ourselves. Now, I say that the notion of overkill is absolutely as preposterous as to say that we have enough BB bullets to kill, that we have more BB bullets than there are Russians. The fact is, can we keep them from launching an aggressive war? And the fact that we have enough megatonnage to destroy every Russian is a naive answer to my question.
I don't think so.
And you don't specialize in naive answers, usually.
There are an enormous number of things that of which I could be accused, but I would never concede that there was anything naive about the concept of overkill, and I would not like anybody to think so. But going back to deficits.
But it is naive.
Going back to deficits, how do you respond to an administration which is committing itself to continuing and increasing deficit financing under conditions of high inflation? Are you in favor of that?
I'm in favor of a lowered trajectory.
I think
trajectory.
That's a yes or no question.
No, a yes or no question is something bright than me.
The Reagan administration...
The answer is you can't stop inflation dead by any means that anybody would tolerate, any more than you can stop crime by executing double parkers. The answer is you've got to lower the trajectory of inflation. And it's not going to go to zero, and you know it's not going to go to zero, and there isn't anything we could do that you would tolerate that would make it go to zero between now and Thanksgiving. So I want to go down this way, and one way for it to go down is to cause people's marginal tax rates to go down in order to make it profitable for the per capita income to increase. This would yield higher revenues and give us precisely the situation that President Kennedy quite correctly anticipated in 63.
Strikes me as an elaborate, rather eloquent, but on the whole, unpersuasive evasion.
Why?
Well, let me put the question back to you. We are going to have an increase in the deficit. We're going to have a reduction in taxes which contributes to that increase in the deficit.
I don't think we will have an increase in deficit.
Where did you get that idea?
Well, from my reading.
I think you're going to have to read more carefully.
Perhaps. I have had to rely on the statistics issued by the Democratic administration.
Would you?
They predicted first zero, then 16, then 61. It's going to be 81. I think it's going to be less than 81 in fiscal 82.
Okay. Well, let me concede your point.
Okay.
Let me concede that we're going to have a large... marginally decreasing deficit. My figures are not of that sort.
Mm-hmm.
Would you have tolerated that from a Democratic administration?
It would depend completely on surrounding circumstances. I think, for instance, the deficit is not extremely important if the percentage of the public sector spending is going down. For instance, if we spent a total of $100 million a year and we had a deficit of $100 million a year, I wouldn't be upset.
Don't you find yourself struggling a little bit to maintain your love for Ronald Reagan?
No, I think he's very lovable.
And you find yourself forgiving him his economics in order to maintain your affection?
No. The only quarrel I have with Reagan is that he hasn't gone far enough. He's going in the right direction, but he hasn't gone far enough. He should come out for elimination of capital gains tax right away. He should come out for letting people who invest their money in savings get the dividends from those savings without paying a tax on them. He should come out against double taxation. As a matter of fact, he should come out for a lot of the things that Lester Thoreau the book that you consider the most exciting economic book published last year.
you're diverting the discussion again from my question. Have you encountered the so-called horse and sparrow theory of economics?
Sparrow, Kenneth Sparrow, sure.
Beg pardon?
Kenneth Sparrow?
No, the horse and sparrow theory.
Oh, no.
Well, you've just given an eloquent statement of it, and I invite your agreement. It is, if you feed enough oats to the horses, there will be some left over on the road for the sparrows. Seems to me that this is the kind of metaphor which has a rich meaning as compared with those of yours of the BB bullets.
Well, since this is metaphor explanation time, I invite you to elongate that one.
Well, my basic point would be that one way or another, one has to find in this way some moral excuse for reducing taxes on the affluent. And that on the whole, yours is about as persuasive as any. But the fact is that people who pay high taxes would like to have the money to spend, not to save necessarily.
Yes, you wrote a piece about that.
And that
that's true.
And that this should be admitted.
I think you're absolutely right. And I think the people who want civil liberties ought to admit that they want civil liberties because they want to use them.
They're rather well.
Now, I don't suspect anybody who says I'm in favor of civil liberties like Ari and I are of saying, you want to make a living off pornography. I don't suspect anybody who says I want clean air to say, well, he's really an asthmatic. He just wants clean air. That's his only interest. I assume that people who are in favor of lightening the tax load are in favor of lightening the tax load because they would prefer to spend that amount of money the way they want to rather than the way the government wants to.
What you're saying, Bill, is that you're in favor of the same kind of massive obfuscation with which you respond to some of my rather simple questions. Let me be precise. You're saying that while well-to-do people in the 50% bracket and in unearned income going up to the 70% bracket, do not like to pay taxes, would like to have the money to spend, they must produce some deeply moral obfuscation. Such as the fact that they're going to have, they need the incentives.
Why is it an obfuscation?
That they're not working and they need to be encouraged to work harder.
Why is it an obfuscation for somebody who hits the 50% bracket at $30,000 to say, I would like to save enough money to be able to send my children to school? Or he might say, I want to take a world cruise. I don't care. I mean, I think that one of the things that we ought to respect in one another is your right to use civil liberties to write the kind of books you want to write. And you ought to respect my right to earn money in order to spend it the way I want to spend it.
We get over to civil
including buying your books.
We get over to civil liberties. We got back to Hitler as we got to those minority and Jewish students.
Sure, because I despair of anything less than eschatological imagery shaking you out of your trance.
Couldn't we stay with the subject?
The subject is somebody suspect who says, I want lesser taxes, and says also lesser taxes are going to benefit the economy? I say no more so than somebody who says, I want civil liberties, because civil liberties is going to enrich the culture.
No, I don't really have any objection to that.
Even though it can be abused.
That's all right, that. I don't have objection to that. What I object to, or slightly amuses me, is the person who says, well, of course, I'm in these high brackets. And I need a tax reduction in order to stir me to greater effort, in order to cause me to have the incentives which will make me work harder.
Well, I think it's very often true.
Would you?
I think it's very often true, because a lot of people invest in tax shelters, and those tax shelters are often as unproductive as buying antiques. Now, if somebody is the biggest antique collector in the whole world because he finds that putting his money into a savings account or into equity simply results in 70% of it being taken by Uncle Sam, and he says, I will stop buying antiques and do that other stuff, I think he's speaking very convincingly, and I'm not sore at him.
Do you think that American businessmen are sort of laying down the job, investing in tax shelters because they're because of the high taxes?
I think we have built a dynamic that requires anybody who is concerned for the integrity of his savings, let alone increased savings, to look for ways in which to invest them that tend to be inflation-proof. That's why people have such a hard time buying a piece of land or renting an apartment in New York City or elsewhere, because inflation is forcing people to put their money the only places that they think they're safe, places like land, stamps, antiques, art, you know.
You're saying you're very hard on the affluent.
I'm not hard on the man who has earned $50,000 and is trying to struggle to coexist in a world, the economic architecture of which was devised by people like you.
I come on with some difficulty in getting your attention, Bill. What you are saying is that the affluent in this country, I find myself defending them, the affluent in this country have sort of soldiered off. They're not working. They're putting their money in tax shelters.
What do you mean by affluent now? You hit 50% bracket at $30,000. Now, let's take a taxi driver. Let's take a taxi driver. Suppose a taxi driver has to decide whether he's going to work another 10 hours a week. And he finds out that 50% or 50% is going to go to the government, he might very well decide not to work another 10 hours a week. And therefore, he cuts down on the productivity.
This is an extremely unconvincing effort of your... You to identify yourself with the proletariat.
I'm talking about 50% bracket. Let me, 50% bracket is what you hit at $30,000 a year if you have no dependents.
Yes, I would agree with you on that, and I would lift that. I've advocated it, yes. But what I'm concerned with is, let's talk about the 70% bracket, or let's talk about the Ford or General Motors executive. You're in effect saying that this man, laying down on the job, soldiering off.
I'm
spending
saying
time with a mistress or something of that sort.
No, I'm saying that there's
concerning,
less.
Well, let me talk for a moment.
Okay. But you see, you keep telling you use your time to say what I'm saying.
Yes,
it's very upsetting because I'm not saying that.
This is an absolutely marvelous thing, because I can't help but marvel at your need for somebody to translate your English into English. You're saying that the great business executive of this country, who I consider to be a hard-working man, needs this tax reduction in order to get back to work. Now is that true, Bill?
Look, there are 300...
I'll give you your chance to talk.
All right. There are 300,000 enterprises begun in America every year. Three-fifths of them last 5 years, i.e. they go bankrupt. The median income of the people who launch those enterprises is less than that of a New York City sanitation collector. So I don't think he's affluent in the sense in which you're talking about affluence. Now, when he sits down to decide whether he can afford to start into business to develop a better mousetrap, he's got to think in terms of accumulating savings, capital. He's got to find capital. Capital is now available at 18%.
Could I interrupt just a word?
Or 20%.
That mousetrap is a bit of a cliche, don't you think?
I know. Yeah. I know. That's why I want to use it.
Yeah.
A better mousetrap is the universal symbol for some new enterprise. Well, call it a laundry, call it a apartment building, call it what you like. The fact of the matter is that these people, and the GNP shows that these people are not acting because there are too many things in their way, regulations and taxes. You might write a manifesto about this.
The point that I wanted to press on you is that about roughly 60% of all production, roughly two-thirds, comes from a couple of thousand large corporations. That is the American economy. And it is the executives of those corporations who are the moving force, not your mousetrap builders, romantic as they are.
I disagree with you.
Let me finish.
I know that's the thesis of book number two, but I disagree with it too.
Let me finish. Sure. Well, you can disagree, but the statistics are on my side. Now, are these executives of yours, are you really saying they're laid back, doing nothing? And let me ask one simple question. Bill, you must be...
Are you really asking it? Because you just finished asking another one.
You must yourself be in the 50% bracket, or close. Would you work harder? Are you going to work harder if your taxes are reduced?
No, because I can't work harder.
So you're agreeing with me that the money will be nice, but the incentive effect will be zero.
But I might change the nature
of my
investment.
That's a metaphor of our whole discussion. I now have your agreement.
All right. Now, in the last 8 years, we have swelled our... We have granted 10 million more jobs in America. We've made 10 million more jobs. Of those 10 million, less than 50,000 were made by the two-thirds major corporations you're talking about. So the activity, the fresh activity, is by the small people. And it is the small people who are suffering because they cannot accumulate savings and because they cannot reap revenues in an inflationary situation. But we must not unhappily, return to our examiner, Mr. Arya Nair, formerly with the ACLU, now a teacher of law at the New York Law School.
New York University Law School.
New York University, sorry.
I don't want to join a faculty which hasn't appointed me. Mr. Buckley, I wonder if you would agree that the Reagan administration's plan to increase military spending itself has an inflationary effect.
Well, sure. Any public sector spending has an inflationary effect.
And do you expect that the Soviet Union is simply going to respond to the increased military spending by not trying to keep up with the United States? I mean, I think the Soviet Union has about the same view as you have about overkill. They're willing to go for more and more capacity to wipe out the United States, and they seem determined to keep up with us. Do you think they'll lay off now that the Reagan administration is in control?
There is a lot of sophisticated discussion on that point. You see, they are now spending somewhere between, as I said a moment ago, 15% and 18% of the GNP. Question, how much more can they spend?
Well, they don't have
without causing internal conditions.
Yeah, but they don't have a population that is able to protest very well. They can't be turned out of office at the next election.
No, I don't doubt that they operate by tyranny. And if you say, can they squeeze yet more?
Or do you think they're determined to squeeze they might yet more?
What's that?
Or do you think they're determined to squeeze yet more?
I think they're determined to achieve supremacy, but of course, what they have going for them primarily is that the high cost of manpower for us is a very small cost to them. For us, it's 65%, for them, it's about 20%. Now, that being the case, they are able to rely on massive production and also on technology, and it is that direction in which we have a natural edge, in which we can probably dollar for dollar outmatch them, even as we did in landing on the moon.
I wonder if Mr. Galbraith would agree with me that Mr. Buckley's answer seemed to suggest that he ought to oppose the Reagan administration's plans to increase military spending. He doesn't want inflation, and he does seem, even though he hedges, to agree that the Soviet Union is going to try and keep up.
Well, I have a feeling that Mr. Buckley, Bill I often call him, is going to agree with the Reagan administration, however extravagant the effort, however improbable explanation he can produce.
Now the question is, will the Reagan administration agree with me? I started it all.
And there is a case for, and I suppose there is a case for this blind political loyalty.
I came out for rearmament when Reagan was a member of the ADA. So cut that out.
again, this archaeology that we have been faced with here today, Bill.
Well, here I read about you when you were 11 years old. Well, go ahead.
Well, Mr. Galbraith, you have talked about the importance of spending on social services, and I wonder how you feel the heterogeneity of the American population is likely to play a part with the kinds of cutbacks that we get from the Reagan administration. Do you anticipate that because the cutbacks are likely to fall heaviest on people who are not only at the low end of the income scale, but are different from the majority of the population by race or ethnicity, that is likely to exacerbate in any fashion the kinds of social problems that will result from Reagan economics?
Yes. Most of the benefit from the tax reductions, and all of it in the large, in the appreciably large sums, is going to go to the top of the income bracket. And the largest and most severe cuts are in aid to dependent families with dependent children, the food stamps, rent supplements, things which are of the CETA, Comprehensive Employment Training Act, which are of the greatest importance in the central cities, where there is already social tension, where youth unemployment is already 30% to 40% among minorities. And I regard this as wrong and mildly reckless, that the risks that are involved here, and now I speak as a conservative, the risks that are involved here seem to me to be unacceptable. That capitalism, the free enterprise system, has survived in all of the industrial countries, not alone the United States, by a consistent, continuing effort to remove the rough edges, to keep it from impinging painfully on the people who are the least fortunate. And I do not like to see this process reversed. As Bill rightly said, it was something that got an enormous start with the New Deal, has continued as part of the central thrust of the consensus under both Democratic and Republican administrations since and in the other industrial countries. I'm proud to have been a part of it, and I would like to see it continued.
And the inflation will continue if we continue to do what you tell us to do. My comment on that is that nobody is hurt more than poor people by inflation. Go ahead.
No, on the contrary, nobody is going to be hurt so much by these cuts, Bill. But on the other hand, I'm not for inflation, and that's why I react so strongly against these large tax cuts in combination with the high military expenditures. That's why I again find myself, surprising as it is, looking at you and saying, here is Galbraith the conservative, who is not, however, captured by the need to be loyal to a president.
Well, if we need a third world war to make you anti-inflation, it might almost be worth it.
Why do we move on to a war right now?
But because that's exactly what's going to happen if we don't beef up our military expenditures, if we become a sitting duck for the Soviet Union, like Afghanistan.
I have the notion, Bill, that your polemical device has, which is manifestly skillful. That's why I so much enjoy this program. But that it is increasingly getting to the device of, I hate to say this, but the irrelevant.
Well, can I pursue that comment about inflation hurting poor people the most? I think that is probably true of every evil. They all hurt poor people the most. But when you have cuts in spending by the government on programs that involve poor people, and those poor people are separate from everybody else in ways that poor people are not necessarily separate in, say, the countries of West Europe, isn't there going to be a rather more immediate problem, a perception that the government is using its strength in order to pay for the military budget, which will provide jobs that are not available to poor people?
I guess the only way I can answer that, Mr. Nye, is to say that Reagan won the election. These issues were precisely exchanged ad nauseam between Carter and Reagan, and the overwhelming majority of the American people, every state including Massachusetts, voted for Reagan.
Sure, but you
because
didn't.
Because they
give up.
They interpret reality.
Yeah.
The way I interpret it, much more than they do the way you and Mr.
Galbraith interpret it. You didn't give up criticizing the Carter economics when Carter won. I mean, one is entitled to continue criticizing Reagan, whether or not he won.
No,
and simply to retreat into saying that he has a mandate seems to me absurd. I mean, that would cut off all political debate.
Well, no, but what you're trying to say is that disruptions are going to occur as a result of his carrying out his mandate. And I say, A, I don't think they will. And B, if they do, we've got to either surrender the democratic process or simply quell those disruptions.
No, it's not surrendering the democratic process. One can make him see the light.
Had David Stockman and these cuts in the central cities been heard of before the inauguration?
Well, by those who were well read.
You really saying that?
Yeah.
you know something? You're wrong.
The commitment to
cut social services in the central cities was something that came up after January 20th, and you know that as well as I do.
If you mean the detailed cut, when he said that he was going to reduce spending by X billion dollars, it wasn't going to be because he was going to stop having diplomatic receptions in the State Department. Obviously, anybody with any sense. What he said was that he would not touch four categories of things called the safety net, and he enumerated those.
Such as,
you know that, don't you?
And he said one of those was Social Security. One of those categories.
Yes, it was.
Did he touch that?
He touched it.
No, he did.
And somebody's going to have to touch it. He shouldn't have made that promise.
Oh, I see. So we now have one case where Buckley is solidly against the administration.
So is every Democrat. I don't know anybody who is responsible who says we can't make a change in the Social Security laws. Everybody recognizes we've got to have to make a change, or else everybody who is under 65 is going to be working to pay money to everybody who's over 65.
Let me ask you another question.
We have 45 seconds.
How do you feel about these big increases in farm support prices for farmers that are already...
I'm against them.
Wait, pardon?
I'm against them.
How do you feel about restriction on Japanese imports?
I'm against them.
So then, on the whole, you would take you're in favor of the Reagan administration only when it attacks the poor.
I'm in favor of the Reagan administration when it agrees with me. Thank you, Professor Galbraith, author of A Life in Our Times, his memoirs, widely acclaimed and justifiably so. Thank you, Mr. Arianea. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen of the New York University Debate School.
Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and by other public television stations, and by the following. For a printed-bound transcript of this program, send $2 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. Indicate the subject of the program, and please allow 3 weeks for delivery. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content.